We're continuing this series on the book of Ephesians. With this important book, the Apostle Paul teaches us about who we are, our identity, who we are and what we're made out of, who we are in Christ. Our identity is taught through this book. Not only that, the Apostle Paul teaches us how to live. So in doing that, he talks a lot about different relationships that takes place in our lives. So with a good understanding and application of these truths, we can come together and build and be a part of a church that glorifies God and reflects His image to the world. So the first half of the book, I told you that chapter 1 through chapter 3, Apostle Paul talks about the important doctrines of Christianity. And then with those doctrines, the second half of the book, the Apostle Paul talks about applications. With those doctrines, here are practical ways of living Christian life. And we continue to see that in this passage for today. And Apostle Paul is giving us several specific instructions for us Christians. His main message of this passage is this: be careful. That's his message. That's the overarching message of this passage that we just read. Be careful. Look carefully how you walk. You don't just randomly walk to different places. Every step of your way, every step of your life, Apostle Paul says, watch your step. Be careful. Be careful how you live. Be careful how you walk. As Christians, you don't just live according to how you feel. You don't just live according to the standards or the patterns of the world. There are some specific ways, specific instructions that God gives us. And in order for you to live a Christian life, you better walk carefully. You better live carefully. Watch your step. Be careful. And he doesn't just say be careful. He says be very careful if you go to NIV version. Be very careful. Now, before we even get into the instructions, I think the two things that we get out of this message from just this verse, when he says be careful how you walk, not as unwise but as wise, I think there's two things that we could draw out of this verse from this very simple message. And number one is this: Christianity is marked by a lifestyle that makes careful steps in our walk with the Lord. And for those of you who are taking notes, I'm going to repeat this again. Christianity is marked by a lifestyle that makes careful steps in our walk with the Lord. And if you don't make these careful steps with the Lord, Bible says, then you are living as unwise. Better translation is, you are a fool. You are not a wise person anymore. If you don't carefully choose your steps, if you don't carefully watch where you're going, you are living your life as unwise, not as wise. Bible talks about this a lot. This idea between being a fool and being a wise. This idea between foolishness and wisdom. Some passages say, you have done foolishly. You are a fool if you are not keeping the commands from the Lord. We see that in many passages in the Old Testament. He says, you are a fool if you are not following God's commands. When Job lost his children, lost all his possessions, he's struck with the illness, his wife looked at him and said, just curse God and die. This is hopeless. hopeless. We lost everything. We lost our children. We don't have a dime, a single penny, and now you're sick. You believe God? Just curse God and die. And what was Job's response? His response was, "You of a foolish woman." What a foolish thing to say. What a foolish thing to say. In Psalm, there are many passages that says, the fool says in his heart or in her heart that there is no God. That's what fools do. Fools say in their hearts that there is no God. In the book of Luke, Jesus gives us a story about a rich man whose land was just so plentiful, so productive, he became even richer. And he goes out to the field, he looks at all the things he has, and he says to his soul, "Let's drink, let's enjoy, and let's be merry, for I have a lot of these things." And God says, again, "You fool, what if tonight I take your soul away? You fool, thinking that your little possession that you have is everything there is to it, to your life. What a foolish thing to say when you forget to involve God in your life." And the Apostle Paul is saying the same thing. As Christians, we cannot just live our lives just as we please, just as we feel, just as other people draw us to different places, without having any thought of God, our Father, in the center of our lives. And that's why he says, so you have to be very careful. Be very careful how you live. Be very careful how you walk. Because if you don't, you're going to be living your life as a fool. Walking and living with God means to walk in wisdom. And to walk and live in wisdom is to walk in the light and to walk with the Lord. I love the book of Ecclesiastes. College and young adults recently finished a study on the book of Ecclesiastes, but that's the theme that gets repeated after and repeated and repeated by the King Solomon. Be wise. Don't be a fool. Be wise. Seek wisdom. Ask for wisdom. Don't be fools. My parents were really good at this. When I was young, when I was a teenager, when I was in high school, you know, you're exposed to a lot of temptations, right? And usually high school parents that have high school kids will usually say, "Oh, you know, don't do this, don't do that. Oh, don't smoke, don't do drugs," and all that stuff. My parents were really wise. All they said to me was this: "You're a child of God. Don't be dumb." That's all they said. "You're a child of God. And you know that you are a child of God. Don't be dumb." So turn to the person next to you and say this: "Don't be dumb." Come on, say it. Don't be dumb. And yes, I admit there were some occasions when I still acted as a fool, as a teenager, and even in my college years. But having my parents just repeating this time after time, "You are a child of God. You are a child of God. Don't be dumb." It really reminded me of my identity and helped me to grow and be mature. So when Apostle Paul says, be very careful. Be very careful how you live, not as unwise, but as wise. The first thing we get out of this is, number one, we have to understand that Christianity is marked by careful walk with the Lord. But there's another thing that I want to talk about is this. We got to be smart to listen to the spiritual leaders around us. We got to be smart. We got to be willing to listen to the spiritual leaders around us. Foremostly, we got to go to the Word. We got to go to the Scripture. That's where the teaching comes from. That's where the truth comes from. But there are spiritual leaders that God has placed in your life that are giving you guidance, counsel, advice, encouragement, whatever that may be. You got to be willing to listen to these people, to these spiritual leaders. As baby Yoel is getting older, now he's 10 months old, it seems like Debbie and I are saying this very often in our house, and that is this: careful, Yoel! Don't do that! Be careful, Yoel! We say this like many times throughout the day. Now he's crawling, he's trying to stand, he's grabbing onto stuff. Just a couple days ago, I was trying to get something from the pantry, so the door was open, and then Debbie was freaking out, and I was like, what is it? It turns out baby Yoel came to the door, and where there was a little gap, he put his finger in it, and he was trying to close the door. And she was just freaking out. He said, be careful! Careful! And just a couple days ago, we heard him like chewing something, but we didn't give him anything. So we knew it was a bad sign. So I approach him and I go, what is it? And I look into his mouth. There was this sharp plastic piece that he was about to swallow. So I was freaking out. I put my finger in his mouth and then just trying to get it out. He's like, I finally got it out and I told him, come on, be careful, man. Well, obviously, he doesn't understand, but come on, be careful. It's not edible. You don't eat these things. I was working at a warehouse a couple years ago. And the first day I went to this warehouse, first thing that caught my attention was the forklift. And I don't know if you ever worked at a warehouse, I don't know if you ever driven these forklifts, but these things are pretty cool. And I love to drive anything. So I saw this forklift, it looks cool, it's got this cool handle, and there's this stick that goes like in many different positions, and this thing is supposed to drive itself, and it's got the fork that can lift things up and down, and it's a lot of stuff that can go on with just these two things. And I was just being dumb, you know, I should have asked for permission, but I got on it and just like started driving itself, you know. It was so much fun. It's the first day of my work at a warehouse, and I almost killed someone. I got in a big, big trouble. Apostle Paul says, be very careful. Be careful how you live. Be careful how you walk. But be also willing to listen to other people that are around you that are giving you the advice or the counsel or the encouragement, whatever that may be. You got to be able to listen to those advices. Let's think about it. If I saw Yoel trying to do the same thing, crawling to the pantry door, it's slightly open so that his finger can fit inside. I don't just sit on the couch and I go, oh, here comes it again. Just a little more, Yoel, just go, just a little more and just put your finger in there. That's it. Okay, now try to close that door. I don't do that, right? I don't do that. As soon as I see even the slightest sign of him getting hurt, I go and I protect him and I tell him, be careful. When I was having fun with that forklift and I got into big trouble, my manager came to me and said, you're supposed to follow some procedures. There are certain procedures that you got to follow. This thing is really dangerous. You can kill someone, which you almost did, but you know, you got to be really careful with this. And he was giving me all these instructions, and I was able to understand the necessary steps that I had to take to drive this thing. So today with this passage, Apostle Paul is giving us this teaching. And he says, be careful. I'm going to give you some things. I'm going to tell you some instructions. But I really hope you listen to me. Because I know how easy it is for all of us to fall. How easy it is for us to stumble. If you don't be careful, if you are not very careful, it's so easy for all of us to fall. So with that, let's move on. There's actually six things that the Apostle Paul talks about, and I'm going to go one by one, and it won't be too long, so I'll try to go quickly. But the first thing that he says is this. If you go to verse 16, he says, make the best use of the time, because the days are evil. By the way, the title for my message today is called Safety Procedures. So I'm going to go step by step on some of the things that we have to be very careful about when we live our lives as Christians. First thing he says is, make the best use of the time because the days are evil. First thing is this, be ready for opportunities. Be ready for opportunities. He says, make the most of every opportunity. Make the most of every chance you get. He says, make the best use of the time. Now, he is not saying you need to make use of time in general. He says, make the most out of the time. What does that mean? He is talking about a definite amount of time. Paul is not telling us to make the most of every single moment of your life. Although that would be ideal, we know that's not possible. He is telling us to seize the opportunity when you are given one. He is teaching us to seize the opportunity when you are given one. Doesn't mean that you make the most out of your 24 hours a day and make it more productive, but when you are given the definite amount of time to do something, make the best use out of that time. Make the most out of that opportunity. Seize it and make the most out of it. In essence, it doesn't mean that in a 24 hour of a day, you should do less of your stuff, you should do less of sleeping, less of relaxing, less of enjoying yourself, and do more of Bible reading and more of worship and more of Bible study and all that stuff. That's not what he's saying. He's saying when you are given an opportunity, seize that opportunity and make the most out of it. Why is that important? He says because God gives us certain opportunities and we have to have the spiritual eyes to see that. Every day is an opportunity. Every moment is an opportunity. Every relationship that you have in your life is an opportunity for you to display image of Christ. And the Apostle Paul is saying, seize that opportunity and make the most out of it. Don't just let it pass by. That's an opportunity from God. Seize it. Make the most out of it. Take that opportunity. Every struggle is an opportunity. Every fall is an opportunity for you to get back up again. Every failure is an opportunity for you to reflect on yourself and understand how you can grow out of it. Make the most out of that opportunity. Every storm in your life is an opportunity for you to focus on the Lord. Make the most out of those opportunities. He also goes on by saying, it's important because the days are evil. And I think you and I can agree very easily that the world that we're living in right now is very evil. The things that are taking place in the world, just turn on the TV, just look at the news, we know a lot of the things that are going on in our world is evil. We look at our government, we see a lot of things that are evil. We see injustice, we see hatred, we see division, and we know these things are evil. But you know, most evil thing is when someone is away from the Lord. Most evil thing is when someone is away from the Lord. And the Apostle Paul says, you see that? Seize that opportunity. Share the gospel. In these evil days, God wants us to seize any opportunities presented to us to share his love and his message of the gospel. Brothers and sisters, even today, there will be, I guarantee you, there will be opportunities that will be presented to you. Don't just let it pass by. Seize those moments and glorify God. Secondly, verse 17 says, therefore do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. We have to be scripture-filled. Be scripture-filled. Second item on the list on this safety procedures is be scripture-filled. Don't act thoughtlessly. Don't act foolishly. Don't live carelessly. You got to watch your step. You got to live very carefully. You got to think before you act. You got to think about it before you make your next move. But think about what? Apostle Paul says, you got to understand what the will of the Lord is. Understand what God desires in your life. Understand what direction God wants you to go to. Understand how fast he wants you to go to. Understand who God wants you to go to that with. Understand the will of your master. And in order to do that, we have to be filled with the scripture. We have to read it. We have to study it. We have to remind ourselves of the biblical teaching before you make your actions, before you take your actions, before you make your next move. Seek counsel from the scripture. With Pastor Joshua's Sabbath, we are having some guest speakers come and preach for Korean ministry. And we are having Pastor Son, who used to pastor Bethel Church in Irvine, come periodically to preach for Korean ministry. And I remember this story that he told us a couple months ago, but this is what he said. He was so in love with the scripture. He was so in love with the Word of God. Every day, his favorite time of the day was just going to the scripture and just reading the Word of God. And he talked about a story where his family were on a vacation. So this is when he was in the East Coast. I think he was in Maryland. But they were going on a vacation, which was about 6 hours of driving from where he was. So all his family, they packed up, they drove about 6 hours, 6-7 hours. They got there, they're unpacking, and then it was middle of the night. He realized that he didn't bring his Bible. Now, most of us will just say, it's okay, I got my smartphones. Well, back then, maybe we didn't have smartphones, but most of us will probably just say, it's okay, just a couple days of vacation, I could just go back home and continue reading. But this is what he told us. He said, he stopped unpacking his bag, got back to his car, drove another 6 hours back to his house to grab that Bible, and then came back down to his vacation lodging. And then he was talking about how happy, how excited he was as soon as he grabbed his Bible and put it in his arm, put it to his heart and said, and he actually prayed to God and said, God, I will never leave your word again. I will never leave your word again. Do we have that kind of zeal for the scripture? Do you? I mean, with smartphones, we could probably just easily download like 10 different kinds of apps of Bible on here in just 1 minute. But do you love it? Are you filled with the scripture? How many of you finished making your New Year's resolution? Not many of you. Can we make this one of your list? Better yet, let's make this on the top of your list to read Bible every day, to love the scripture. Apostle Paul says, if you want to be very careful with your steps, with the way you live, you got to love the scripture. Verse 18, number 3, be spirit-filled. Be spirit-filled. He says, do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit. Now, why is being filled with the Spirit being compared to getting drunk? Remember the day? Or remember the night when you got really drunk? Now, don't raise your hand. I mean, you got drunk. You got wasted. You don't even remember what happened. You don't remember what you said. You don't even remember who you were with. You were just gone. One shot of whatever led to another, and you just got wasted. Remember that day? But see, even after getting that drunk, after some time, you are sober again. Even after getting wasted, after a couple of hours, you are sober again. I was having a brunch with one of my friend who was an alcoholic. And this was brunch, mind you. And this guy started drinking. And I'm not talking about just a couple sips of wine. He was just like drinking hard liquor during brunch. I was like, you okay, man? But this is what he said. He said, yeah, I just hate this feeling of being sober. He just hates this feeling of becoming sober again. So as soon as he does, he starts drinking again. Understand this. Being filled with the Spirit is the same thing. Being filled with the Spirit is the same thing. It's not a one-time event. Being filled with the Spirit is not a one-time event that we live off of for the rest of our lives. It's a filling that needs to happen consistently and continuously. Sometimes we go to the retreat, sometimes we go to the conferences, or even on a Sunday worship, we come out of these things and go, wow, that was great. I feel like I'm filled with the Spirit. How long does that go? You and I know very well, as soon as the reality kicks in, we feel weak again. We feel lazy again. We feel like we're defeated again. And you know what? That's when you need another dose of Holy Spirit. You need that daily dose of Holy Spirit in you. You don't want to be sober of the Holy Spirit. You want to be drunk with the Holy Spirit. As soon as you become sober of the Holy Spirit, you seek Holy Spirit and be filled with the Spirit. Now, this verb, to be filled, number one, it is a passive verb. And this is so important because what that means is you don't make it happen. You can't just say, today I'm going to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Yeah! That just doesn't happen. It's a passive verb. Being filled with the Spirit is a passive verb. You simply come before God, invite the Spirit in your life, and ask God to fill you up with His Spirit. Second thing about this verb, it's an imperative. What that means is this is not an option. It's a command. It's a command from God. So if you want to live and watch your step very carefully, Apostle Paul says, you got to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Ask him to fill you up. And understand that it's not an option, it's a command. Constant filling of the Holy Spirit, this daily dose of the Spirit in your life will give you the divine power and energy to live through the day with wisdom and courage. One of the commentators said on this verse, alcohol is a depressant, for it loosens and depresses people's self-control, wisdom, balance, and judgment. But the Holy Spirit has an exactly the opposite effect. The Holy Spirit is a stimulant. He moves every aspect of our being to better and more perfect performance. Be filled with the Holy Spirit. Be filled with the Holy Spirit. Number four, verse 19. Addressing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody to the Lord with your heart. Number four, keep track of your heart. Keep track of your heart. When we are filled with the Spirit, we have this desire to worship God. When we are filled with the Spirit, we have a desire to praise God and encourage others in that act of worship. And this is not just from our mouth, it's actually from our hearts. When you are filled with the Holy Spirit, it's your heart that moves you. It's your heart that moves you. When you are filled with the Holy Spirit, you don't worship with your mouth. You don't worship by physically just being here and just physically raising your hand. When you're filled with the Holy Spirit, it's your heart that worships God. When you are filled with the Spirit in communities, you don't just encourage others with mouth. You don't just say vain words just to make him look nice or make her look nice or make him feel better or make her feel better. When you are filled with the Spirit in community, we communicate through hearts. Keep track of your heart. Where is your heart right now? A good way to check where you are whether you are spiritually healthy is not to check your words, but to check your heart. You could be saying the nicest things. You could be saying the most holy things. You could look really nice in church, but is your heart in line with God? Be very careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise, by keeping track of your heart. That's why I love David's prayer when he said, "Search my heart, O God. Make me clean. Search my heart, O God, and make it clean." Verse 20. Giving thanks always and for everything to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Number five, remember God. Remember God. When you are filled with the Spirit, you not only desire to worship God with your heart, you not only desire to encourage others and build each other up with your heart, but you are filled with thanksgiving. You are just so grateful for anything and everything, just like how the Bible says right here. It says, give thanks for everything. Giving thanks for everything. Not just this, not just that, but giving thanks for everything. And the next part is also important. To who? To God. What does that mean? Going backwards, everything in your life came from God, whether good or bad. Giving thanks is not something we do only on the Thanksgiving Day. But every day and everywhere, we are to give thanks. Why? Because God is alive and He is with us every day and everywhere. So every day and everywhere you go, give thanks because God is with you. Because everything in your life came from God. Once you stop thinking about this, you begin to see things otherwise. Once you begin to stop being reminded of the fact that God gave me everything and everything is good because He is good God, we begin to see things otherwise. We begin to categorize things to our own standards. We begin to compare with others. But let us be reminded, everything that you have, everything about you is from God, and you are to give thanks. Charles Spurgeon said this, "Every hour, yes, every moment has brought a favor upon its wings. Look downward and give thanks, for you are saved from hell. Look on the right hands and give thanks, for you are enriched with gracious gifts. Look on the left hand and give thanks, for you are shielded from daily ills. Look above and give thanks, for heaven awaits you." Book of Exodus, when the Israelites are led out of Egypt, we see this one word that gets repeated again, again, and again, and that word is this: remember. Remember how God led you out of Egypt. Remember how God had you walk through the parted sea on the dry ground. Remember when you asked for food and we had manna come from heaven. Remember when you were thirsty and water came out of rock. Remember God. Make this a discipline. Remember God. Number six, remember others. This is the last one. Remember others. Verse 21, it says, submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. It's interesting because this verse, verse 21, on some of the versions of the Bible, it's included with this passage that we just read. On some of the versions, if you have NIV version of the Bible, you'll notice that verse 21 is actually included on the next passage, which talks about wives and husbands and marriage. So this is actually a very good transitional phrase. But we're talking about mutual submission in community. Mutual submission as a body of Christ. When we are filled with the Spirit, we show our mutual submission to each other. And it will be done in fear of God, not in fear of men. Did you catch this? Verse 21, it says, submitting to one another out of what? Reverence for Christ. What does that mean? We submit to one another in fear of God, not in fear of men or women. The idea of submission doesn't have anything to do with someone being smarter or better or more talented. It just has to do with God-appointed design. God has a design on how things work, and in that design, we all have different roles. And we'll talk about this later on, but in marriage, it doesn't mean that husband is always supposed to be smarter or better or more talented than the wife, or vice versa. It's simply difference of roles. Husband has certain roles, wives has certain roles. Even between the relationship between parents and children, yes, parents are older, we're more wise, and we understand more things, but it doesn't mean that we are better individuals than our children. Just because they're young doesn't mean they don't know anything and we are better off. Just because I stand here and preach the word of God as your pastor doesn't mean I'm better than you. I'm not. I know I'm not. But it's the role that is given to me, and we're trying to fulfill that role in this God-made design. So please understand, when we talk about submitting to one another, it's not hierarchy of who is at the top, who's below that person, who is below that person, but in a community, it's horizontal relationship of different roles. Someone has this role, this person has the other role, this person has the other role, and together we make the community of Christ. Submit to one another, not out of your respect or honor or some kind of authority, but out of the complete trust in God's design that there must be a reason why some people in your life is in your life. Understand that in God's perfect design, there's a reason why the things happen the way it is happening right now. Understand why some people in your life are in your life. Submit to them. Remember them. Remember them. Don't try to ignore them. But remember them. The Apostle Paul, with this passage from Ephesians chapter 5, tells us, be careful. Be very careful. Christianity doesn't just happen. For you to live as Christians doesn't mean you just start your day and just do random things. Things happen in your life and you just go, oh, okay, it's just being so passive about it. Apostle Paul says, no, there's certain things happen the way it should, according to God's design, and for you as Christians, you are to live very, very, very carefully. So as we close, I just want to ask you to remember these things. And if the six of the things that we talked about was too much, I encourage you to go home tonight and go back to this passage and read it one more time. Meditate upon it. Let the Holy Spirit speak to you. But as we close, I want to take this moment to ask the Holy Spirit to fill us up, to give us this daily dose of being filled with His Spirit. Because without the Holy Spirit, none of these is possible. None of these is possible. We could try. We can attempt. But we will fail. But once God fills us up with His Spirit, we could do all these things and even more. So let's pray together.